issue. So as I said, I'd really like to welcome the presenters from India. There are four presenters today. Professor Baby Venkatesh, who is a professor in obstetrics and has undertaken her undergraduate and postgraduate studies in obstetric and gynecological nursing. Her main areas of interest are adolescent health, nursing education, and moulding students to be the best they can be. She's published several articles and research paper and is pursuing a two-year fellowship program in the Foundation of Advancement of International Medical Education and Research, and she's currently pursuing her PhD. The next speaker is Professor Christy Mekala, and she's a professor in community health and has undertaken her postgraduate studies in community health nursing. She's a resource, currently pursuing also her PhD, and she's a resource person for training the trainers involved in the Global Fund for AIDS, Tuberculosis and Malaria program. Mrs. Shanthi, MD, is also a professor, associate professor in obstetrics and has completed her studies in obstetric and gynecological nursing. She's also published several papers and is pursuing her PhD. And Miss Ancy Mathew. Ancy hails from Kerala and has completed her postgraduate studies in OBG nursing, and her main areas of interest are in pain management in labour. And she's about to get married and in a month's time and is awaiting to start her professional marital life. So welcome to the four ladies from India, and I'll now hand over to them to start their presentation. Okay, Baby, would you like to go ahead?
Yes, yes, Gillian. Thanks for your introduction. From PhD and Coimbatore, we wish you all a very happy Midwife's Day. We are here to present on Safe Motherhood Initiatives from India. Just before going on to the entire topic, this is where we are, India. India has 28 states and 7 union territories. These states are further subdivided into districts. Current population of India is expected to be 1.27 billion, males comprising 655.8 million and females 614.4 million. The state where we are here is Tamil Nadu. Tamil Nadu is one of the most important states. This is 11th largest in terms of area, 7th most populous state in the country. Population of Tamil Nadu is around 70 million according to the 2011 census. It's one of the most urbanized states in India, and this stands second in total employment and holds 6% of India's population. The city where we live is Coimbatore. This is also called as Kovai, the second largest metropolitan city. It is the textile capital of Tamil Nadu. Fourth largest metropole in South India. There are numerous temples around the city and is a home to 7 universities, 3 medical colleges, 35 polytechnic colleges, 70 arts and science colleges, and 54 engineering colleges. It is the educational hub of South India too. This is our institution, the PhD institution. We own a 950-bedded multi-speciality hospital which caters the adjacent population. This is our campus, PSG. PSG institutions has a medical college, nursing college, pharmacy, physiotherapy, engineering, all the courses in it. Adjacent picture what you are viewing is our college, PSG College of Nursing. And this caters a student population of 325, inclusive of undergraduates and postgraduates. Majority of the faculty are undergraduates and pursuing their doctorate programs. So this is one of our classrooms, model classrooms, for final year classroom. Today's topics for our discussion are, I'll be discussing on the maternal mortality rate and trends in India, current education system of preparing midwives, and maternal welfare programs offered at the central government and at the state level. India is second most populous country in the world next to China. Currently there are about 51 births per minute. More than 50% of India's population is below the age of 25 and over 65% below the age of 35. 72% of India's population lives in rural areas. Rest of the 28% are urban areas. And when you take the population of India, every year India adds more people than any other nation in the world. In fact, individual population of some states is equal to total population of many countries. According to the state census 2011, most populated state is Uttar Pradesh with a population of 19.96 crores. The least populated state in the country is Sikkim with a population of 66,7,688. Some of the reasons for India's rapidly growing population are poverty, illiteracy, high fertility rate, rapid decline in the death rates or the mortality rates, and there is a lot of immigration from Bangladesh and Nepal too. Alarmed by the swelling population, India started taking measures to stem the growth quite earlier. India, by launching the National Family Welfare Program in 1952, India became the first country in the world to have a population policy. The family program, planning program has yielded some noticeable results, bringing out significantly highly the country's fertility rate. So this is a global scenario of the maternal mortality rates. The global MMR in 2010 was 210 maternal deaths per 1 lakh live births. That is down from 400 maternal deaths per 1 lakh live births in 1990. The MMR in the developing regions has been 15 times higher than in the developed countries. Sub-Saharan Africa had the highest MMR at 500 maternal deaths per 1 lakh live births, while Eastern Asia, that is countries including China, Korea, Japan, Mongolia, had the lowest among the minimum development goals in developing regions, that is at 37 maternal deaths per 1 lakh live births. This may be owing to China's one-child policy adopted by China in 1978 that has brought about the tremendous results for China. The policy claims to have prevented between 250 to 300 million births from 78 to 2000 and 400 million births from 79 to 2010. The MMR of the remaining millennium developmental goal developing regions in descending order of maternal deaths per 1 lakh live births are Southern Asia, Oceania, Latin America, Northern Africa and Central Asia. The direct causes that contribute to majority of the maternal deaths include hemorrhage, sepsis, unsafe abortions, eclampsia and obstructed labor. And since the rural population is more, the access to healthcare facilities are little less in the rural populations, for which the government of India and the state government is working. This is the MMR, the statistics of maternal mortality rate in India. India, currently the maternal mortality rate is 212 per 1 lakh live births. We have started working towards the minimum developmental goals. Already three states, Tamil Nadu, Kerala and Maharashtra, have reached their minimum developmental goals, and other states are on the way to reach the minimum developmental goals. As we know, this minimum developmental goals are as numerical and time-bound targets to measure the achievement in human and social development laid down by UN. Goal 5 concentrates on improving the maternal health and indicator is the MMR. India, by its all the programs, are on the way of reaching reducing the MMR and reaching its way to Millennium Developmental Goals. So it is not sufficient that adequate planning is done from the part of the government, but also we need a health force that is sufficient enough to implement these programs. As a part of it, government has taken a lot of steps to improve this workforce. So let us see, to improve the nursing workforce, what are the initiatives taken? I hand over the session to Ancy to continue on the workforce strengthening.
Thank you, ma'am. Wishing you all a very happy International Midwives Day. Midwife means with the woman. Midwifery is considered to be one of the world's oldest profession, and India has got a rich tradition on midwifery. In the traditional practice, women from within the community have turned into midwives and they were attending the deliveries. But today, these traditional midwives are replaced by trained certified midwives. Indian midwifery practice is based on midwifery model of care. In this, as per this model, pregnancy and childbirth are considered as normal physiological process and only assistance will be provided to the mother who is in labor. So the components of the model of care includes monitoring the physical, psychological and social well-being of the mother throughout the childbearing cycle, providing the mother with individualized education, counseling and prenatal care, and hands-on assistance during labor and delivery, minimizing the technological interventions, identifying and referring the woman who are in need of obstetrical attention. So initiatives for training midwives in India. Initiatives for training midwives in India is taken by Indian Nursing Council, established under Indian Nursing Council Act of 1947. There are various programs offered by Indian Nursing Council, which includes auxiliary nurse and midwifery, which the basic qualification they need is a 12 year of schooling, and it is a 1 year program, and they will be designated as registered auxiliary nurse and midwife. The next program offered is general nursing and midwifery. The basic requirement is 12 years of schooling. It is a 3.5 year course, and they will be designated as registered nurse and midwife, and they can work in the primary health centers and hospitals. The third program offered is basic BSc nursing program. It is a 12 year of, it also needs a basic schooling of 12 years. This is a 4 year degree course, and they will be designated as registered nurse and registered midwife. And the fourth program offered is master's degree in obstetrics. The basic qualification needed for this is a 4 year basic BSc nursing program, and this master's degree program is for 2 years, and they will be designated as registered nurse and registered midwife. They can practice in the hospital setting as well as they can be in the teaching side. So even after having this many programs, there is still a lag of 3.50 lakh nurses against the total need of 10.43 lakh nurses in India. So Indian Nursing Council, along with the Trained Nurses Association of India, have introduced the program of independent nurse practitioner, which is already being implemented in the states of Kerala, Tamil Nadu, Gujarat and West Bengal. Under this program, trained nurses are expected to take up normal deliveries in the sub-centers and primary health centers in the absence of doctors. As for this independent nurse midwifery practitioner, this program is focusing on utilizing the knowledge, skills and authoritative power of midwives, and they will be accountable for the care what they are doing. Along with all these things, taking care of the female, they also take care of the male patients also who are suffering with sexually transmitted disease or reproductive tract infections. And under this program, a continuity of care is expected out of the midwives. What is the scope of midwifery practice is, they can even after doing their specialization, they can further specialize in areas where they are interested, like they can work as lactation consultants, they can focus only on postnatal care, or they can focus on complementary therapies which can be provided during labor, like acupressure, reflexology, naturopathy and other things. So India is expecting that out of all these programs, There will be a decrease in the maternal mortality rate and infant mortality rate, and the Millennium Development Goals will be achieved. So the other programs which is conducted by the central government and state government will be discussed by Professor Christy. Thank you.
Hi and warm greetings from PSC College of Nursing. I'm Christy here. I wish you a happy International Midwives Day. India is a developing country and we are in industrial demographic stage. That means we have high birth rate and low death rate. We have achieved the death rate here. Our nation is taking diverse steps to reduce our growth rate. So from the starting from history in 1946, actually Bohr committee, they have recommended the primary health care focus. And 1952, we have started with family welfare program. It is the first nation we are concentrated on birth control. And comes to after that 1978, it is the millennium, we have changed in the primary healthcare concept after the Alma-Ata conference held in USSR in 1978. Based on this, we have started with national health policy in 1983 and we have given 12 targets including maternal mortality rate and infant mortality rate. Like MMR, we are focused to reduce to 2 and IMR, we are focused to reduce to 60. But we have started in the year of 1992, child survival and safe motherhood. Here mainly we are concentrated on how to bring the child survival rate and bring the safe motherhood. And after that, it is 1997, it is reproductive child health program, it is started. Here we have, it is incorporated with child survival and safe motherhood is incorporated with RCH. So the components of RCH is family planning, child survival and safe motherhood, prevention and management of reproductive tract infection, sexual transmitted disease and HIV and AIDS. Also adolescent healthcare and family life education. And last one is client approach to healthcare. These are the focus we have started in 1997 and when we are reaching 2001 census, actually we have kept the target for 60 IMR and 2 per 1000 MMR. But we have reached, it is almost 4 per 1000 MMR and 72 per 1000 IMR. So on one goal we have achieved is death rate, that we have reduced to 6 per 1000. Actually we have reached our goal. After that, after 2001, again we have revised the national health policy in 2002. And 2005 we have started with NRHM program. So in the RCH program mainly we are concentrated like decentralized healthcare. And what is the main shift of this paradigm is vertical program into integrated service delivery. Like earlier in our nation it is a very many states are here, so they have focused from central, they have focused all the states and they have concentrated all the programs. But now it is integrated from the peripheral level, they have to start working and they have to tell their needs and demands from the peripheral level. That is the main paradigm shift it has happened here. And it is earlier it is camp oriented, like we'll conduct camps and we'll collect all the mothers or family planning, everything we'll collect the people. But here it is client oriented, they have to come forward, they have to take initiative. Then target oriented, we have set a target and we reach. Here it is goal oriented and we have focused quantity earlier and now it is quality. So quality wise we are improving the whole health service and the peripheral rural level. We are incorporating all the health system services and we are developing the resources in the rural areas. And mainly in RCH program we are concentrating 3 E's, that is early obstetrical care, essential obstetrical care and emergency obstetrical. Here we are focused with mobile services. When they are need, they have mobile services to come to the hospitals or rural health centers. And here this program, it is providing safe delivery kit also. So wherever the delivery is taking place, we have to have a clean and more or less safe environment to conduct the deliveries. That is the main focus in this RCH program. So after that, in 2005, we have started with National Rural Health Mission. It is mainly focused on first 18 states and northern states. Here we are in southern part. So actually southern part, the literacy level and MMR is very less compared to northern states. So this program is mainly concentrated in northern states to reduce IMR, MMR and total fertility rate. And improve the control and prevention of disease like emerging and re-emerging diseases and non-communicable diseases too, and to provide accessible, affordable, accountable and effective and reliable primary health care and bridging the gap in rural health care. Because all majority of our 72% of people, they are live in rural service. And as earlier it is mentioned, it is accredited social health activist. She is working to in rural areas to reduce the birth. And we have GDP, how much we allotted it is. Earlier it is only 0.9% of national GDP it is allotted. Now it is increased to 2% more or less. We are concentrating on preventive and promotive services for safe motherhood. And also we are encouraging public-private partnership. Here, because public-private, if we are combined together only, because this huge population we can meet and we can meet the targets. And promoting IEC, information, education and communication, because women will be educated from the earlier stage, from obstetrical, and during adolescent period also they will be educated, and during adolescent they will be providing iron rich supplements plus iron and folic acid tablets, because here in India the HB, hemorrhage, is the first cause to in the IMS, promoting IMR. So we are concentrating on hemoglobin level among adolescent age group and maternal, during maternal period. And next program we have is in the NRSM, mainly is Janani Suraksha Yojana. It is during pregnancy period they will be given concentration and they will be providing ₹700. It is almost 12 to 13 US dollars. It is only to bring the nutrition, to develop the nutritional status of mother. And this, they have registered early registration, it is must, and registered care and safe institution deliveries we are encouraging, and early newborn care and family oriented care also we are providing here. This program also, it is concentrating first northern part of India, and it is almost 18 states it is benefited out of this. And we have family planning program. Here we are focusing small family norm. That is, in India we have total fertility rate, it is almost around 2.9 or almost 3. And that means all reproductive age group women, they are giving birth to minimum 3 children. So we are bringing this norm, small family norm. That means only any one child, either male or female, one child, if you are giving birth, it is too good, and we are focusing for NRR, that is net reproductive rate is 2:1. Actually it is, our rate is 1.5. We are focusing for 1. All, even though all these things, we have one more thing, problem is, major problem is female infanticide. The female sex ratio, when we are seeing in northern part, it is 800 per 1000. In southern part it is doing well, 900, around 930 they are doing well. So all the whole nation we have average of 930 per 1000, and we are promoting Girl Child Protection Act also we are taking care of. These are the main merits and demerits we have. We have limitation like highly populated country and lack of resource trained professional midwives. When we are seeing midwives, the ratio doctor doctor population ratio we have is 0.7 per 1000. And nurse population ratio is 0.8 per 1000, and midwife population rate is 0.4. Actually we have RN, registered nurse and registered midwife. In India we have combined, that is midwife and nurse certificate program is we are doing, but still we have in auxiliary nurse, midwife and trained birth attendant. They are trained people to conduct deliveries and mainly for focusing on midwives. These are the limitations we have. Although we have all these limitations, we have one strong meritus. We have family system, traditional and cultural practice. When we are going to cultural practice, this is a picture that it's like during the pregnancy period, the family is taking care of the mother, and this is the occasion they'll have 7th and 9th month, they'll do one day, they'll celebrate the mother. And they'll wear all the new silk saris with, she'll be decorated and she'll be wearing bangles. All the relatives and neighbors will wear bangles. This mainly actually focuses that this glass material, it will give more sound. This will produce the cognitive, improve the cognitive skill of fetus. This is the actual practice we are following, and this shows we are our family system and tradition also taking care of our pregnant women. So I wish you all the best and have a nice day. I will just hand over to Shanthi.
Thank you, ma'am. A warm good evening to one and all. Wish you all a very happy International Midwife Day. Till now, we've seen various national level schemes. Along with the other schemes also that state government was implemented, they are Dr. Muthulakshmi Reddy Maternity Benefit Scheme. This scheme was implemented in the year 2006. It is a monetary benefit scheme for the mother. In order to compensate the weight loss during pregnancy, to get nutritious diet, and to avoid delivery of low birth weight babies, this scheme was implemented for the mother. The total money they are giving to the mother, almost $222. This also they are giving in three installment basis. In each installment, the mother is getting around $74. The first installment they are giving at the mother who avails their required antenatal services in a concerned primary health center. Second installment giving at the mother who delivers at government institutions. Third installment giving to the mother who is completion of immunization for the child up to third dose of PPT, hepatitis B and oral polio vaccine. The eligibility criteria are, it is restricted to first two deliveries only. The pregnant mother should be at the age of 19 years and above. The pregnant woman should be in the below poverty line group. That means the mother's annual income should be around $222. And second program, birth companionship program. This program was implemented in the year 2004. It is a key component of midwifery model of care. The development of this program is based on shared responsibility, mutual trust, understanding and empowerment. This program is followed in all over the world, but they are including husband also a birth companion. But in India, only women will be allowed as a birth companion. The eligibility criteria are, the woman should have undergone the process of labor compulsory, and she should not suffer from any communicable diseases. She should be willing to stay with the mother throughout the labor. The benefits of this program are, it gives increased satisfaction with your birthing experience and gives reduction of postpartum depression, gives increased breastfeeding success, and better interaction with mother and baby, and also shorten the duration of labor. It gives less pain and fewer medical procedures during labor, and also reduction of instrumental vaginal birth and cesarean deliveries. And third program is Integrated Child Development Scheme. This scheme was implemented in the year 1982. It gives service to both antenatal and postnatal mothers. That means they are doing weight monitoring for the mother, periodic medical checkup, supplementing nutrition, supplementing iron and calcium medications, and immunization monitoring compulsory. The supplementing nutrition is the main motto of this scheme. They are giving this supplementing nutrition to children with below 6 years of age, antenatal mothers and lactating mothers. Each pregnant and nursing woman, the diet covers around 600 calories and 18 to 20 grams of protein per day. Along with this, they are giving health education about child care to the postnatal mothers also. Till now, due to this scheme, 718,000 children, 156,000 pregnant women and 875,000 lactating mothers were benefited through this program. Next program, Comprehensive Emergency Obstetrics and Newborn Care Unit. This hospital is initiated mainly in rural areas because in order to reduce the maternal mortality rate in emergency conditions. Because 70% of population were resided in rural areas, this scheme was implemented in rural areas. According to gross domestic product, the government allotting 4.7% of income to implement this type of centers. It is well equipped with both manpower and equipment to require to give care for the mother and baby. This center has round-the-clock the obstetrician, pediatrician, doctors,
staff nurses, lab technician and other supporting staff on duty. The services available are induced resuscitation of all emergency conditions, blood transfusion facilities, supportive lab and imaging studies, prevention of parent to child transmission services, free 108 emergency ambulance system and emergency treatment protocols in the labor room and also in the newborn care services. The next program is Medical Mobile Unit. This unit was developed in the year 2009. The aim of this unit is to improve the institutional deliveries, to identify the high-risk pregnancy, and it is easy to approach for the population and also refer for emergency care. The services available from this unit are routine immunization monitoring, antenatal care, postnatal care, family welfare services, and referral and counseling services. And next scheme is Vande Mataram scheme. It is a voluntary scheme. The enrolled doctors will display Vande Mataram logo at their clinic. So they are providing iron and folic acid medication, TT injections, and oral pills at free of cost. Through these state level of schemes, the Tamil Nadu achieved in the year 2007 to 2008, 99% of mothers were had institutional deliveries and only 0.1% of mothers are delivered by untrained personnel at home. Due to the institutional deliveries, the maternal mortality rate was reduced gradually in both state level and also in national level. Thank you. I will hand over to Professor Dairy Ma'am.
So with all aiming towards the Millennium Developmental Goals, there is no doubt world needs us more than ever. India also celebrates on April 11th National Safe Motherhood Day so that citizens and communities and other stakeholders take a pass, deliberate on the maternal health situation in the country and look at what interventions are working and what more is needed to be done. This April 11th is It's a birth anniversary of Kasturiba Gandhi and Safe Motherhood Day is commemorated to mark the occasions. I now let the forum open for discussion.
Thank you very much, ladies. That was a lovely presentation. There are certainly a couple of questions that are coming through. And I'll refer the first one. One of the participants was just asking in relation to the education. We noticed that the midwives and nursing education was together. Are the midwives and nurses referred to as nurses or are they called midwives? Baby, could you answer that question, please?
Yeah, sure. We have a basic program of BSc midwife nursing education, nursing. So this BSc nursing, those who graduate on that will be able to work as educators and also as a clinical midwife. And after their post-graduation also, they can work as educators and a clinical midwife. The option is for individual to choose either of these areas. They can be allowed for both education and also in the practice setting. Is it clear, Gillian?
Yes, lovely. All right, thank you very much for that. One of the other questions that came through was in relation to the slide that you had about the caring for the mothers and wearing the bangles, given that the mothers appear to be quite well supported postnatally, do you have any idea in relation to the levels of postnatal depression that you experience in your country?
Yes, this bangle ceremony is almost done in South India. This is kept that a day is marked, an auspicious day is marked, so people all get together to make the mother happy, wear bangles. Usually it is done in the seventh month. We can also state that this also improves the acoustic skills, the hearing abilities of the newborn, which the mother will be wearing this bangle till her delivery. And also...
Okay.
A mother is given a lot of nutritious food throughout the pregnancy, her relatives will be bringing her seeds, fruits and things so that they care for the mother, not only as a family but also as a society, her relatives all too, which will be keeping the mother pleasant too, happy too. So they...
Okay, excellent. Now, I think there's a question from Soma. So, Soma, can I, you've got the microphone. Can you ask your question, please?
Yeah, we had noted out certain questions, like in India, majority of the births are mostly handled by doctors, not necessarily, because there are a lot of areas where midwives themselves are conducting, and not necessarily all the doctors are in the hospital or conducting institutional deliveries majority of the time, and they are to prescribe, they are to suggest the procedures, and midwives are the one, those who are carrying out everything for, they have the responsibility starting from preconception care till the mother gets delivered. And if only complicated, we referral to doctors is that. And we have the next question. Already there is in the chat section there was an answer on it. Is there an independent nursing practitioners program? Yes, of course there are already 3 states that is on the way to delivering of this independent practitioners program. There is, and there are a lot of initiatives to further make more nurses practice independently. Then there were like, why men do not go for vasectomy? Usually it's men do go for vasectomy, but in a very quite less numbers. Majority of the permanent contraception is undergone by females, and temporary contraception, of course, both equally opt for it.
Okay, thank you very much for that, Soma. We have a question from Penny, and she said, with the dramatic rise in institutional birth and doctors attending, so an obstetric model of care, how much care do you feel is women-centred and how is this ensured?
Yes. As we discussed earlier, 72% of the India's population lives in rural areas. So majority of these births, we are trying to make it institutional because to avoid the complications, the transport facilities they get from the rural area to the birthing center is less, and also since it's a very much rural area, even the availability of nurses there is difficult. So all care is women centered only, but promoting institutional births to avoid complications of the delivery.
Thank you. Okay, so they're trying to encourage the amount of institutional birth to prevent, obviously, the mortality rate. Is that correct?
Yes, yes. This is to reduce the complications of delivery and childbirth.
Okay. I know one of the other questions that was put forward before is, if the doctors are handling most of the births, I heard one of the presenters say that the midwives' roles and responsibilities are certainly involved around the postnatal area and complementary therapy. So just to clarify, do the midwives actually do any of the births or assist the mothers to do any of the births?
Midwives definitely do, majority of, except like even in hospitals, midwives do deliver, but there is a little of preference when there are complications arise, it is to doctors, and the majority in primary health centers only midwives deliver. And main responsibilities are like starting from history, assessment, monitoring the fetus and the mother, maintaining a pathogram, conducting the delivery. Maybe when there is a teaching institution, medical colleges attached, so there is a tendency for doctors to get practice too.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Does anyone have any other questions that they'd like answered? You can yes. Please raise your hand in the chat box if you want to.
There is a question to like increasing number of cesarean sections. Yes, there are increasing number of cesarean sections, maybe again to avoid complications of the, to reduce infant mortality, stillbirths and mortality rates. That's why they opt for a cesarean section.
Excellent. One of the questions from Henrietta here is, what is the cesarean section rate in India?
Rates we cannot specifically point out. Maybe around 10 to 20%. That depends on, no?
10
depends on the mothers.
10 to 20%. So is that's in the public arenas? Because Priyanka here on the chat box is saying 50 to 80% in private hospitals. Is that
There is increasing number of cesarean deliveries. We do agree some private hospitals, they take the mother for cesarean section, but it is not a condition throughout India.
Okay, excellent.
Yes, there is an association called SOMI, Society of Midwives of India. There is association. We all belong to Train Nurses Association of India, and midwives belong to this. We conduct yearly. There is conferences, and there is a network that is between the midwives.
Okay, thank you. Sana, do you have a question? I'll just enable your microphone. Sana, do you have a question? Sana, can you go ahead if you've got your question, please?
No problem. You can type it. We'll be answering for you.
While we're just waiting for her to do that, Penny just has a question here. Do you think midwives would be interested in autonomous practice?
Currently there are several midwives coming up. I think in the future definitely there will be a lot of midwives doing autonomy practice.
Okay. Priyanka, I've just enabled your microphone. Do you want to... she's got her hand up, sorry, I can see that you don't have, unable to use the mic. So she said, isn't hemorrhage linked to higher rates of induction in hospital rather than hemoglobin levels alone?
I don't think so. Hemorrhage is not related to induction in our hospitals. Hemorrhage is a cause, but that is related to anemia, less hemoglobin levels. It is not of a... not related to induction, but related to hemoglobin levels.
Levels, yep, excellent. Okay, has anyone got any further questions?
No, hemorrhage is not much linked to induction here in India. Hemorrhage is related majority to anemia, going to anemia.
Very good. Thank you very much for that, ladies. Do you think that the induction rate obviously is increasing too? And I suppose there's a... obviously there's got to be a correlation if you're having more institutionalised births with your induction rate. And can I just ask, when is your induction rate, what is generally the cutoff for women to be induced? Is it 41 weeks, 42 weeks?
We couldn't get you again.
Sorry, can I just ask, what is the most common time for induction in India? Do they normally induce women at 41 weeks or 42 weeks?
40 plus when the baby is matured enough. 40.
Okay, so about 40. Okay, that's great. It's just very interesting to hear the different, rules around induction in different countries. Here in Australia, it's normally about 41 plus 3 or 40 plus 10 days. So, and that's just dependent, you know, in what area, but that's generally the norm here. So I was just very interested to know what was the norm in India.
Definitely, I think you're talking on the nutritional programs that has definitely reduced the anemia rate in women.
Okay, excellent. Has anyone else got any more questions they'd like to put forward?
The hemorrhage may be linked to induction, but that is not the cause of the majority of the hemorrhages here.
Okay, lovely ladies. Well, thank you very much for that presentation. It's just been wonderful to have the four of you, and I think that presentation went so well. It was, you all spoke really, you know, very clearly. It was lovely, so thank you very much. I'll just turn the recording.